So now we'll talk about lower lid ectropion, which is similar to lower lid entropion, but with a different set of pathophysiology as well as appearance. For lower lid ectropion, it refers to eversion of the eyelid margin. And you can see over here in this patient with a unilateral left lower lid ectropion, there is presence of the lid margin that is showing very obviously with the loss of actually lid globe apposition. You can also see that there is inferior conjunctival chemosis as a result of the poor eye closure and leg ophthalmos that this patient has as a result of her lower lid ectropion. For history taking, it's also similar for the presenting complaints as entropion, and it includes teary eyes, red eyes, foreign body sensation, eye pain, as well as eye discomfort. For examination-wise, again, it's similar to entropion. However, in particular in this case, we also need to take note of the lateral displacement of the puncta because we encounter this more commonly in ectropion as called to entropion. And the other thing that we are to note for ectropion is the presence of a seventh nerve palsy that can often result in the ectropion that we see. So what are the different types of ectropion that we can encounter? Involutional is probably by far the commonest, followed by paralytic, which is in the setting of the seventh nerve palsy, and this can either be in the upper or the lower motor seventh nerve palsy. And in cicatricial ectropion, it can occur in skin conditions like ichthyosis, thermal skin burns, or acid injury. And also in mechanical ectropion, where it's secondary to large tumors of the lower eyelid. So how do we perform assessment of the ectropion? We need to elicit the cause of the ectropion, as mentioned in the previous slide of the types of ectropion. And we also need to assess the lower lid laxity, which is even more important to address as compared to entropion. And when assessing the lid laxity, we do not just have to look at the medial laxity, but also the whole length of the laxity. In particular, we also need to look at the position of the punctum in order to assess and perform management for ectropion. So for non-surgical management for ectropion, again, we can use lubricants. We can perform taping of the lid in the ideal position. And it also includes tarsorrhaphy, which can either be temporary or permanent. Temporary can be used in the setting of Bell's palsy, where we would expect some recovery, and permanent, where we do not expect any recovery of the nerve function, and also especially if there is a permanent deficit that's likely to be encountered. What about surgical management for ectropion? We can address the medial laxity by performing mild surgery for mild medial laxity, and this will include medial conjunctivoplasty. If it's a moderate degree of laxity, we can perform a lazy T procedure, which actually refers to medial conjunctivoplasty with a tarsal wedge resection that's lateral to the punctum in order not to damage the canalicular system. And in severe medial laxity, we can perform a medial canthal tendon plication and a wedge resection. If the whole length of the lower eyelid is lax, we can actually perform a lateral tarsal strip procedure or a wedge resection procedure, quite like the entropion surgery. So how do we perform a medial conjunctivoplasty, especially when we have punctal ectropion? When we look at the medial conjunctiva, we can actually perform a medial diamond wedge resection of the conjunctiva, look for the lower lid retractors, and hook the lower lid retractors by using a double arm suture here. And then we perform this suture going through the anterior edge of the conjunctiva that we have cut of the diamond, going through the inferior fornix. When we do this, this edge, which is the anterior edge of the diamond, will actually oppose the posterior edge of the diamond. And these sutures actually exit through the skin inferiorly here below and are tied off. So if we see this on the sagittal section, we actually see that we're actually catching the lower lid retractors, going up the anterior diamond edge, going posteriorly into the fornix, and coming out again through the skin. This actually produces an inverting effect for the punctal ectropion, as well as for the lid margin that's medial, that's ectropic, as well as to address any medial laxity here. When scarring takes place, you can see that this is the direction in which the scarring will form, and hence it will actually help to hold the punctum towards the inward direction. What about the lateral tarsal strip? We have already gone through this in the entropion lecture, but just to recap, basically we fashion a lateral tarsal strip by performing a lateral canthotomy, inferior canthal lysis, remove the anterior lamella, fashion the strip, diaphragmize the posterior conjunctiva to prevent cyst formation, remove the lid margin, and then oppose this lateral tarsal strip onto the lateral orbital rim periosteum, thus addressing the horizontal laxity. What about for medial canthal plication? In medial canthal tendon plication, we actually insert the Bowman probe in order to protect this system, and we actually pull the medial end of the tarsal plate with a double arm suture, possibly a 6-0 vicro would be good, going through the orbicularis muscle and hitching it onto the medial canthal tendon, which needs to be isolated. And this can be performed with a nice tear trough incision. What about for cicatricial ectropion? Usually this needs to be addressed with a skin graft, because this usually happens when the skin is too tight, like in a burns injury or a chemical injury. So the scar tissue has to be firstly released, followed by pulling up and releasing and undermining all the skin traction and the skin tightness. We then perform this with a skin graft that can be harvested either from the supraclavicular region, from the upper lid, from the contra upper lid, or even on the inner arm and or the post-auricular region, to actually put the skin graft in place with minimal skin tension. And this is then sutured down with the sutures and with a sponge in order to minimize the formation of any bruising in that area that may cause the graft to fail. What about for cicatricial ectropion, where we do not want to use a skin graft? You can also perform a Z-plasty, which will actually allow for the skin release of the scar. And as we see over here, you can do this with a 60-degree two lines that are actually 60 degrees to the scar that you see. So if this is the scar, by performing two dotted lines like that at 60 degrees to the scar, you can actually cut this area in order to release the two flaps A and B, which are then transposed, rotated, to allow for the scar release as seen here. So the tip here of A, as seen from here, created here, it is held in the forceps here, it's transposed and placed inferiorly. So this is how you release a Z-plasty scar. So these are some pictures who have gone through surgery. As you can see on the pictures on the left-hand side, they are preoperative, where there's the presence of the ectropion and the conjunctival inferior chemosis. And over here, this is postoperatively, where you see that there is excellent lid globe apposition with a very well-formed lateral canthal angle. And this is how the patient's face looks postoperatively, bearing in mind that these patients may be actually post-blepharoplasty. Cosmesis outcome for such surgery is also very important. And if you'd like to read up more on the topics that we've just discussed, you can refer to the following textbooks. Thank you for your attention.